Hey guys, I just wanted to take a minute and talk about a few things before getting into today's video. First, I just wanted to say thank you for all of the support on my last video. I haven't had the time to respond to everyone, but I read every comment and I want you to know that I appreciate all of you for taking the time to watch the video and to leave some kind words. It really means a lot. I also have to say a special thank you to all of my new Patreon supporters and all of the people that sent me something on PayPal. It's been helping me stress a lot less these days, and I can't thank you enough for that. Also, for those wondering, I'm definitely not sick or anything. I'm hoping it stays that way, but I've been doing my part, only going out for essentials, washing my hands thoroughly, so I should be okay, but I'll keep you all updated. And one more thing before we get started, I wanted to give a big thank you to this video's sponsor, Raid Shadow Legends. Raid is a fantasy RPG that allows you to take control of your own fortress and champions that can be fully customized to fit your playstyle. With an extensive PvE campaign, you can work together with friends to tear down bosses, or you can put your skills to the test in the PvP battle arena. Best of all, it's totally free to play on both mobile devices and desktop, and now the Battle Pass is on. Season 1 is live right now, and you can win rewards of all kinds like energy refills, gems, upgraded artifact sets, and new champions by completing the daily and weekly challenges. You can find me under the name FilmRadar to join my clan, and if you follow the links in the video description, not only will you be helping to support my channel, but new players will receive 100,000 silver, 50 gems, 1 energy refill, and 1 free champion, Adjudicator, that you can find right here and will be available for 30 days. In any RPG, personally, I'm always fond of mage characters, so this dark elf Kyle has been my go-to, and so far he's been putting in some serious work. If you want to try it out for yourself, just follow the links in the description and claim your rewards today. Given the current situation, I, like many, have been returning to Steven Soderbergh's film Contagion to see what might be on the horizon if the disease continues to spread. It is obviously a fictional story about a fictional outbreak, but according to many scientists, it actually gets a lot of things right in how it portrays not only the science behind the virus, but the public response to an outbreak of this scale. So how does a virus spread, and how is it eventually stopped? In the case of the fictional MEV1 virus, the virus is zoonotic, meaning that it transfers from animals to humans.
Somewhere in the world, the wrong pig met up with the wrong bat.
Day 1, when the infected pig is handled by a butcher who doesn't wash his hands, he transmits the disease to Beth Emhoff, the index patient or patient 0. Throughout the first day of infection, she's not showing any symptoms and infects others unknowingly. And when her and 2 of the other infected all hop on different planes, the disease makes its way to a few new countries. Day 2, we start to see early deaths while infected clusters pop up in the areas visited by those who've contracted the disease, but it's still just getting started.
Kowloon is the most densely populated area in the world, and Hong Kong is a harbor. It's going to spread.
Within a week, it spread to several other major cities in the United States, and clusters are showing up all over the globe, as the number of confirmed cases sees a massive spike over the following weeks.
Last night, there were 5 deaths and 32 cases.
We have 47 cases and 8 deaths.
We're seeing large clusters in from Frankfurt and Cairo.
Government officials are reporting the closing of Mondale Elementary School.
Contact with infectious diseases that are highly contagious.
Don't talk to anyone. Don't touch anyone. That's the most important thing.
On day 1, there were 2 people with it, and then there were 4, and then it was 16, and you think you've got it in front of you. But next it's 256, and then it's 65,000, and it's behind you.
89,000 cases at this point, and that we are heading toward 267,000.
In 30 steps, it's 1 billion sick.
The WHO estimates the number of people infected worldwide to be over 8 million.
With a vaccine, we can anticipate that approximately 1 in 12 people on the planet will contract.
The death toll in the United States is now believed to have reached 2.5 million. The president issued a statement today from an undisclosed.
The death toll and the total number of infected continues to climb and eventually reach its peak as the number of susceptibles decreases, until scientists develop a vaccine somewhere around day 35.
The Food and Drug Administration is accelerating approval of the MEV1 vaccine currently in production at 5 secret locations in the US and Europe, saying the first doses could be available for human use within 90 days.
Finally reaching the end of the worst days with a final death toll of 26 million people. So how did it spread to that many people that fast? Is that even possible in the real world? As it turns out, theoretically, yes.
So at this point, I think we have to believe this is respiratory. Maybe fomites, too.
What's that, fomites?
It refers to transmission from surfaces. The average person touches their face 2,000 or 3,000 times a day. In between, we're touching doorknobs, water fountains, elevator buttons, and each other. Those things become fomites.
You can spread the disease even without presenting symptoms, and you could end up contracting the disease through something as simple as touching a contaminated surface or breathing in pathogens in the air when standing too close to an infected person. There's a mathematical equation used to quantify how infectious a disease may be, which is crucial in determining the potential scale of an epidemic.
What we need to determine is this. For every person who gets sick, how many other people are they likely to infect? For seasonal flu, that's usually about one. Smallpox, on the other hand, it's over 3. We call that number the R-naught.
Any ideas what that might be for this?
How fast it multiplies depends on a variety of factors. The incubation period. How long a person is contagious. Sometimes people can be contagious without even having symptoms. We need to know that too. And we need to know how big the population of people susceptible to the virus might be. Once we know the R-naught, we'll be able to get a handle on the scale of the epidemic.
This isn't a hard number that stays the same throughout the process. In fact, that number can be lowered through preventative measures like quarantine or vaccination. And when everything is working properly, that can eventually bring the reproductive rate down to 0, which is what happened for SARS. And by day 9, they have their number.
Using our model based on an R-naught of 2, here is where we expect to be in 48 hours.
Essentially, this number tells us how likely the disease is to spread upon contact with an infected individual, considering the many different factors that affect transmission rate, like age or pre-existing medical condition. But understanding a virus's R-naught just helps us to understand the scale of the outbreak. There still needs to be an ongoing investigation into how it all began and how to keep it contained.
It's also why the World Health Organization is sending an epidemiologist to Hong Kong. It's hard to know what it is without knowing where it came from, so our first job with these things is always to find ground zero, figure out how it jumped into the population to begin with.
By tracing back step by step through the chain of infected, eventually you find your way back to the beginning, which helps to answer important questions of how this disease was transmitted to humans in the first place, what sort of people are more susceptible, as well as to follow a trail to the other infected areas, and to help implement the proper procedures to contain and to mitigate the effects of the outbreak.
Mhoff is the indexed patient. We need to know everywhere she went before the casino.
We're isolating the sick and quarantining those who we believe were exposed.
And arguably, the most important step in the process that happens concurrently with finding its transmission rate and origin is studying the virus itself in a lab to eventually find a cure. This involves first being able to grow and observe it in a lab setting, and then testing as many attempts needed until they develop a successful vaccine. But even then, it's still a long and complicated process until it could ever reach the public.
If we even had a viable vaccine right now, we would still have to do human trials, and that would take weeks. And then we would have to get clearance and approval, figure out manufacturing and distribution. That would take months. And then train survivors to give inoculations. More months, more deaths.
Though the film speeds this process up quite a bit. In total, from the initial outbreak to widespread vaccination was only a span of about 6 months. To contrast, Ebola was first discovered in 1976, but we didn't see an FDA-approved vaccine until just last year. Generally speaking, one of the biggest complaints within the scientific community about the film is how fast and efficient the public response to the crisis is.
Now in the movies, it's quite different. There's a group of handsome epidemiologists ready to go. They move in, they save the day, but that's just pure Hollywood. We're not ready for the next epidemic. The failure to prepare could allow the next epidemic to be dramatically more devastating than Ebola.
So all of this can feel very scary, like we might be on the verge of something even worse than what the film presents. But I think it's important to manage our expectations, and Contagion does not provide the best model for predicting how things will play out for COVID-19. There are countless articles from scientists analyzing the film to clear up any concerns, and we can always just look at the hard data presented in the film to see how it differs from our current reality. Earlier we talked about the R-naught, which is the average rate of transmission for an infection. By the end of the film, the MEV1 virus has mutated and reached an R-naught of no less than 4, with an estimated mortality rate rate of 25%. Currently, COVID-19 has an R-naught of between 2 and 2.5, with the CDC and the WHO estimating a mortality rate of around 2%. In other words, the coronavirus is half as infectious as the fictional MEV1 virus, and not even one-tenth as fatal. For perspective, on January 22nd, there were a total of 580 confirmed coronavirus cases. By March 15th, there were around 170,000. But for the MEV1 virus, in that same time frame, it had spread to 10% of the world's population and killed a total of 26 million people. Because as it turns out, they take some creative leeway with the science to make their fictional pandemic more severe, like the time before transmission. We see Beth get infected and within the same day is already able to spread the disease to multiple others. In reality, it would take some period of time, at least days, for her to shed the virus from her respiratory tract or saliva. It takes a while for a virus to make enough copies of itself to spread through the body and actually make a person contagious. For COVID-19, that's looking like 5 to 6 days. There's also the rate of death, which seemingly affects people of all ages and backgrounds equally, which is uncommon in most viruses, and it certainly kills in a much smaller window of time than anything we're seeing with COVID-19. Basically, the progression of events in the film isn't entirely implausible, it's just not very realistic. While it does make for a more thrilling film, ultimately it is just a movie, and not some crystal ball vision of our future. Though, that's not to say there aren't worthwhile lessons that we can take from the film. Don't go out if you're feeling unwell, wash your hands thoroughly and often, and for the love of God,
stop touching your face, Dave.
Don't be this guy.
Cover your mouth, please.
Fuck off, lady.
Don't be these people, because ultimately you're just hurting other people who are just as scared as you. So try to stay calm and look out for others. Try to be a helper whenever possible, because the world needs it. And don't forget about the people who are sacrificing their own safety to look out for the rest of us, often going entire days without food or sleep, putting themselves at risk and facing incredibly difficult decisions that no one should ever have to face, and sometimes even making the ultimate sacrifice. So do what you can to make their lives easier. They deserve it. We also need to remember that while we may be the dominant species on this planet, we're not invincible. All it takes is one tiny microbe to potentially unravel everything. And we need to look closer at how these things start so we can do everything in our power to make sure this never happens again. We need better environmental protection that doesn't disturb every natural habitat that remains, because the more we fight the natural order, the more it fights back. We need better preparations for this sort of event. I mean, if every country has protocol in place for nuclear fallout, you'd think we'd be better prepared for something that epidemiologists have been warning us about for years. We also need better food safety regulations, because these meat markets are breeding grounds for disease, and frankly, China was under scrutiny well before this novel coronavirus for its bad practices with food sanitation, with many rightfully predicting that the next epidemic crisis would originate there, the filmmakers behind Contagion included. They also rightfully predicted the way that the world would act in the face of a global pandemic, where those with privileged information will look out for themselves before ever giving a warning to any of the rest of us, how governments will do anything they can to suppress the truth if it makes their country look bad, how there will be panic and profiteering and a lot of fear and uncertainty before it's all said and done. But the thing that they get correct that matters most for all of us right now is that they got through it. And we will get through this too. I'm in no way, shape, or form an expert. I have no idea if this will all be over in a few weeks, a few months, hopefully not longer, but what I do know is that we're still here. The human race has survived much worse than this, with much less for medicine or technology, so this won't be the end of us. But at the same time, this is a serious situation. If the world scientists are telling you to stay home, then that's what you should do. When they tell you that you're endangering those around you by going out, they're not being dramatic or incendiary, they mean it. So listen to the science, stay informed, and please stay safe.
I understand, thank you, but I can't let you in.
We just can't take any chances.
If we all practice good pandemic protocol, we can have a severe impact on the scale of what we're looking at here. And the bar for doing your civic duty literally could not be any lower, so you have no reason not to. All you have to do is stay indoors unless otherwise necessary, keep social interactions limited, and self-quarantine if you're feeling unwell. And we just have to wait out the worst of it. And if it does get worse from here, well, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it, and we'll get through that too. But we all can have an impact on our world, and I think now that's more clear than ever before. So I think we all just have to try to make sure that our impact tips the scales in the right direction. And if we feel we can't do much else, the least we can do is to be kind and compassionate. Everyone is being affected by this, some more than others, and kindness goes a long way in difficult times. Anyways, that's my two cents, and thank you for watching.